أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم brothers and sisters, and welcome to the Imam Hussein Islamic Center. Happy belated Eid, inshallah. I know we're about 1 week late for the celebration, but Eid fell on the Friday, so this is the first opportunity we had. Inshallah, if you haven't registered, if you can register at the door, there are lucky door tickets and some prizes, inshallah, towards the end of the program. Now, without further ado, if we can begin the program with recitation of the Holy Quran by Brother Ali Murhi. If we can invite him with salawat, salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
صلى الله على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم ربكم من رحمته ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا وترى الشمس إذا طلعت تزاور عن كهفهم ذات اليمين وإذا غربت تقرضهم ذات الشمال وهم في فجوة منه ذلك من آيات الله من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا وتحسبهم أيقاظا وهم رقود ونقلبهم ذات اليمين وذات الشمال وكلبهم باسط ذراعيه بالوصيد لو اطلعت عليهم لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا وكذلك بعثناهم ليتساءلوا بينهم قال قائل منهم كم لبثتم قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم فابعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة فلينظر أيها أزكى طعاما فليأتكم برزق منه وليتلطف ولا يشعرن بكم أحدا إنهم إن يظهروا عليكم يرجموكم أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا وكذلك أثرنا عليهم ليعلموا أن وعد الله حق وأن الساعة لا ريب فيها إذ يتنازعون بينهم أمرهم فقالوا ابنوا عليهم بنيانا ربهم أعلم بهم قال الذين غلبوا على أمرهم لنتخذن عليهم مسجدا سيقولون ثلاثة رابعهم كلبهم ويقولون خمسة سادسهم كلبهم رجما بالغيب ويقولون سبعة وثامنهم كلبهم قل ربي أعلم بعدتهم ما يعلمهم إلا قليل فلا تمار فيهم إلا مراء ظاهرا ولا تستفت فيهم أحدا صدق الله العلي العظيم صلى على محمد وآل محمد
Please recite a salawat for him and his family, inshallah. It's always nice when we see youth getting up and reciting. It takes a lot of courage to get up and even speak on the microphone, let alone recite. So if we can all recite a salawat and a fatiha for all the marhumin and for all the marhumin of the family of Brother Ali May, who just recited Quran. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Now, inshallah, to give a little bit of a treat before we get into the main part of the program, we have a poem by young sister Zahra, who can we invite her up with a loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
It's Eid today. I can see the tiny new moon up there in the heavenly sky, surrounded by the beautiful twinkling stars, heralding the happy coming of Eid. It's Eid today. Thank you, Almighty Allah, for giving us so much happiness, for the moon and the stars and everything we have. The glad tidings of the season that reminds us of your greatness, the acts of purification that we undergo to show you our loyalty. The prayers we say to seek you from our blessings. On this occasion of Eid, which brings us so much joy, it is Eid today. Salawat.
Please recite another salawat for her well-being and the well-being of her family. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Next on the agenda, inshallah, we have a presentation by Brother Abd Ali, if we can invite him with a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani r-rajim. Bismillahi r-Rahmani r-Rahim. As-salatu was-salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala Ali al-Tayyibin al-Tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Welcome everyone, and Eid Mubarak to all of you. I know it's not the most happiest of Eid, because we are in a position where our Muslimin around the world are being oppressed. And one of the reasons they are being oppressed is because of the lack of knowledge that is prevalent in our communities. There is lack of knowledge in terms of those people who claim, for instance, for example, that the Palestinians are Sunni and we shouldn't be protecting them, or that that Lebanon is Shia and we shouldn't be protecting them. This is coming from the other side as well. Unfortunately, this is just fitna that is being created by those who are trying to create a rift between the Muslimin. Inshallah, today I wish to introduce a new book that we are publishing. In fact, it's published. It's ready, available. It's going to be available outside today. This is actually a small book, relatively small book, and the author has actually taken historical narrations from the Sunni sources to show the eminence and the preeminence of the imams of the Shia, all the 12 imams. And it's actually a rare book, because if you show this to a Sunni and you look at the evidence that is provided in this book from, Tabari, from Muslim, from Bukhari, from all of these sources, there's not one negative word that they can give about our Imam alayhi salam. That is the beauty of this character that these illustrious characters presented in their societies. So inshallah, this is one way in which we can counter this narrative of the Shia versus Sunni, and inshallah educate our Sunni brothers and educate ourselves on the importance of the Imam alayhi salam. Salu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Thank you, Brother Abed, for that book, inshallah. We are all excited to grab a copy and read it, inshallah. Without further delaying the program, if we can recite three loud salawat as we invite His Eminence Sheikh Mansour Al-Ghai via Zoom. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Jazakallah khairan. Thank you, Brother Ahmad and everybody. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wassalatu wassalamu ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina wa Tabib Nufusina wa Habib Qulubina Abil Qasim Muhammad. صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لمقدمه الفداء. Respected brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. For the pleasure of the soul of those dedicated volunteers who used to be with us, no longer they are physically around, in particular, Marhum Faramarz Khalilifar, Marhum Haj Hussein Azimi, who dedicated the last 20 years of their life without any fail, without any stop, wholeheartedly supporting this Baitul Hussein. Marhum Haj Maryam Hijazi, and also for sure let us remember all Marhumin, particularly Shuhada al-Muqawama, all those innocent men, women and children that unfortunately during these atrocities that is happening in the Middle East, particularly in Palestine, are being martyred. Inshallah we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, As-Salawat ala Muhammadin wa Ali Muhammad. Today also marks another atrocity that unfortunately happened almost a century ago, 100 years ago, that I will at the end read a short ziyarat for the Imams of Baqi, that about 100 years ago, those so-called Muslims that I refer to them as Kha'in al-Haramain al-Sharifain, not Khadim al-Haramain, those who are hypocrites and have occupied the holy cities of Mecca and Medina and the land of Hijaz under the fatwa of their most hypocritical scholars, they had destroyed the maqamat of the holy Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, with the assumption that if they destroy the bricks and the walls, they can ever destroy and extinguish the light that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has illuminated. يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفَأُ نُورَ اللَّهِ بَأَفْوَاهِمْ وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ وَالْمُشْرِكُونَ وَالْمُنَافِقُونَ. Inshallah, soon time will come that we will regain these holy places, inshallah. And at the end of, inshallah, I should remember, and we should remember from next year, to have a special program for this occasion. There is a shortcoming, I must say, from our end. Inshallah, this year and tonight will be a starting point and we'll continue it from the years to come. With salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad again. All right, the main reason for me disturbing you tonight, for those who've been with us before the holy months of Ramadan, they remember that we had a presentation for the volunteers, particularly, although I understand that respectfully we have volunteers and non-volunteers, although you're all volunteers one way or the other to this Baitul Hussein, but particularly we had a session for the volunteers before the months of Ramadan, discussing some of the issues that is important and useful for us educationally. And tonight, because there is a humble presentation to the volunteers, respected and honorable volunteers, respected and honorable teachers, also I wanted to share with you the second part, if you like to call it, of what we had discussed before the months of Ramadan under the heading of For the Cause of God or For the Sake of God. Like the previous session, first I want to introduce to you, to whet your appetite with at least two hadiths to show you the significance of this position that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted you, inshallah granted all of us, to be able to serve for the sake of God, the honor of serving for the sake of God. The first hadith, inshallah, I want to share it with especially with the volunteers, although it includes the teachers as well. But the volunteers, particularly who are holding the majalis for Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam all year round, any of the majalis, happy or sad occasions of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, which are one of the main activities of this Baytul Hussein and similar Islamic centers throughout the year, especially on Friday evenings. There is a hadith from Imam Sadiq alayhi salam that one of the companions of the Imam with the name of Fudail, inshallah you will see the PowerPoints as I'm going through it. Someone with the name of Fudail comes to the Imam, and Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is asking him. Apparently he's from Kufa, and Imam, you know, he's living in Medina. So Imam is making inquiries about the community over there. Imam is asking him, "Atajlisuna wa tatahaddathun? Do you have this type of programs to get together as possible?" And tatahaddathun meaning that you speak our ahadith, you speak about our teachings and our virtues and things like that. The reason that we call such gatherings majlis and plural form majalis is taken from this expression, because they used to get together and hold the majalis. Therefore, it's called majlis, meaning that sitting together. Fudail turns around and says that, Bala ju'il tu fidak. Yes, for sure, Yabna Rasulallah. We have. Ju'il tu fidak, subhanAllah, you need to reflect on this. When they used to say ju'il tu fidak to the Imam, you can learn this expression, inshallah, next time on the way coming to the center or such places, remember to repeat this to yourself under breath. Yabna Rasulullah, ju'il tu fidak. That means that may my life be taken for you. What is the time to give for you? What is a bit of money to give for you? May my life be taken for you. Meaning that I'm wholeheartedly your servant for the cause of God. I'm going there to serve for the cause of God, whatever that is required from me. All right? So ju'il tu fidak is a very strong expression. Then the Imam says that, okay, alhamdulillah, inna tilka al-majalisa uhibbuha. Such programs, such gatherings that you get together and commemorate or celebrate the birth or the shahadat of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt al-Musalam, I love such programs. And then the Imams prays and says that, فَأَحْيُوا أَمْرَنَا يَا فُضَيْلِ فَرَحِمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ أَحْيَا أَمْرَنَا فُضَيْلِ. Revive our affairs. Our affairs, it means our virtues. Our affairs, it means our teachings. That the Imam says that get together to bring our teachings to the community, to educate the community about the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. And may the mercy of God be upon those who revive and bring to life the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. As you can see, Imam, although he's communicating with Fudail, but obviously he's only an example. That's why Imam continues, says, Rahimallah man ahya amran. Whoever in the past, present, in Medina, in Kufa, in Sydney, wherever in the world, who is spending some time, that means that any volunteer, whatever that they do, that are contributing to holding the majalis for Ahlul Bayt al-Musalam, this dua of Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, inshallah, is for them. Hani an lakum. This is one. The second is particularly for the teachers. As I said, of course, it includes those who are supporting the teachers in the classes to be able to teach as well. You are all familiar that there is an ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's a very famous ayah. The translation is like this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if someone kills someone else innocently, without that person deserving to be killed, it's like as if he's killed the whole mankind. And if someone is saving a life, it's like as if you have saved the entire life of the humankind. من أحياها فكأنما أحيا الناس جميعا. All right. Now, there is a hadith from Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam. Can you hear me? Is my voice clear? All right. If there is no problem, please say salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Inshallah, with this, you can invite those who are in the reception to come in as well. Imam Zainul Abidin, there is a hadith explanation of this ayah from Imam Zainul Abidin, a practical explanation. Please be with me and pay attention to this subhanAllah hadith that has multidimensional benefits. A lawsuit was brought to Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam over forced imam to judge. The situation was the following. A man had killed, mistakenly, had killed someone else, and the son of the one who was murdered, who was killed, came to Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam with the murderer, who had confessed that, yes, I killed your dad, but it was a mistake. It was not a deliberate killing. They came to the imam for the judgment. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam turns around and looks at the son of the one who was murdered. Imam tells him that, do you know this man? He says, yes, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, we know each other. I know him. As a matter of fact, Imam says that, does he have any right on you? Because being part of the community, you may have sometimes done a favor to one another. Does this man have any favor on you? Does he have any right on you? The guy goes, yes, he was my teacher, believe it or not. I used to learn from him. He's the one who taught me Quran. He's the one who taught me Tawheed, Nubuwwat, Imamat when I was a kid. But Ya Ibn Rasulullah, we are talking about the blood of my father. So what, he was my teacher? Please listen to this hadith that we have this in Tafsir al-Imam al-Askari and related attributed to Imam al-Askari alayhi salam. Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam tells him that for sure, if he has taught you, the reward of the teaching compensates not only the blood of your father. It compensates, look at the hadith, let me read it from you. Bala wallah, hadha yafi bidima'i ahli al-ardi kullihim min al-awwalina wal-akhirin sawa al-anbiya'i wal-a'imma alayhim as-salam. Imam says that you think that teaching is, that teaching you Islam, teaching you Quran does not compensate for the blood of your dad? If you only knew how important it is, this position of teaching Islam, not only it would compensate the blood of your father, it would compensate the blood of all people from beginning to the end that may have been killed on earth, with the exception of the holy blood of Anbiya, the prophets, and the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Then, look at the rest. Then the Imam turns around and looks at the one who has mistakenly killed somebody else, the murderer, supposedly. The Imam tells him that, Mr. Teacher, if you give me the reward of what you have taught this man, I will pay your blood money, because there must be a blood money now, okay? The guy has to be compensated in a normal case with blood money, because it wasn't intentional. The Imam says that, you know, blood money was not something trivial. It's a lot of money. Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam says that, I will pay the blood money for you. You give me the reward of your teachings. The man says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, you don't need the reward of my teaching. For sure you don't need it. And I'm more in need of that. Here in this conversation, the son of the one who was killed, he says, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, I forgave him and forfeit the blood money. I don't want anything, ibtigha awajhillah, seeking the pleasure of God. Moral of the story, as I told you, this hadith we mentioned it in various occasions, but this part for tonight, for the teachers, don't underestimate the position that you have, the honor that the Almighty God has given you to serve as the teacher of Quran, as the teacher of Islamic studies. That's a very angelic, godly, prophetic position. At the same time, look at how the students and the families of the students, the parents of the students, how much a teacher deserves the respect. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. As usual, conditions apply. Nothing comes without condition in this world, hey? Now, one of the main conditions that in the last session we spoke, and we want to take it, inshallah, from where we stopped and share with you a little bit more, and I won't keep you, inshallah, long tonight because I've got another program to go to after this. But the essence of all the conditions is summarized to one that is the heading for this session. For the sake of God, for the cause of God, meaning that I will be rewarded, inshallah, you will be rewarded in abundance, in so much as we are doing it for the sake of God, not for my own sake. The motto of every teacher, the motto of every volunteer should be what you see, inshallah, on the screen in Surah Al-Insan, ayah number 9, part of the ayah. لا نريد منكم جزاء ولا شكورا. That I'm doing whatever that I'm doing, I am not expecting any compensation nor any appreciation. Absolutely nothing. Don't get me wrong. When we say that a volunteer is not expecting any appreciation or compensation, doesn't mean that we don't have any responsibility towards them. We have a responsibility, obviously, towards them to appreciate, as I will mention some examples of it. But the volunteer herself, the volunteer himself, should not expect anything, any reward, any appreciation, any compensation from anyone, whosoever. However, it's much easier said than done. If I share with you quickly a memory, you will see that how tough sometimes it gets, that we are unconscious that we are not doing it necessarily purely, at least purely for the sake of God. One of my friends, one of the very old friends, he tells me this story that I share with you, that some years ago, it was a custom in the back, I don't know about now, maybe still it is, that some of the esteemed maraji, they would delegate some of their students to go and preach in certain villages, towns, cities, countries, and they would tell them that, look, if the community over there gave you a gift, I'm just being very frank with you, you take it, if it was enough, alhamdulillah, otherwise don't ask anything. You come back, we will take care of you. They would sponsor the preacher and the speaker and everything, all right? He says one of the esteemed maraji, I won't mention deliberately his name, you know why when I tell you the story. He sent me to a village for the month of Ramadan for preaching. I made this intention to myself, between me and God, say, Ya Rab, this Ramadan, purely for the sake of God. لا نريد منهم جزاء ولا شكرا. Even from the marja, from the Ayatollah, I'm not going to take any penny. I want to make this Ramadan only for the sake of God. No money will be asked. No money will be taken at all. To purify my intention and inshallah get a reward for it. He says, throughout the months of Ramadan, I was teaching in a masjid. And once it happened that in one of the nights or days, I'm not sure, I was coming out of the masjid and I was a young sheikh. Maybe people had not taken me so seriously still. I don't know. But as I was stepping out of the door of the masjid, the door was very narrow, quite similar to our entrance door. And some of my students, they were exiting and they ignored that I want to go. Nobody would give me, way to go. I didn't like it. And I stopped one of the boys and says that, hey, I'm not taking anything from you, but at least you need to be respectful to your teacher. This is rude. What's going on here? And I got upset. And they stepped back and now I went. This sheikh, he says that after I went home, I thought about it and I hated myself. I said, Astaghfirullah Rabbi wa atubu ilayh. What happened to your promise? Do you think that doing something for the sake of God, only you are doing it for the sake of God if you are not taking any money? There's much more involved in it. Sometimes you take money, but you are doing it for the sake of God. Don't let shaitan deceive us. Sometimes you are not taking money, but you are not doing it for the sake of God. Not necessarily because if you are taking money, you think that, so I'm not doing it for the sake of God. And not necessarily, I'm not taking money, I'm doing it for the sake of God. Allahu Akbar, inna naqada basir. Now the rest of the story is important. He says, I went back to Qom and I went to that marja and I sat with him and I told him the story. I said, Sayyidina, alhamdulillah, to give him a report. And I said, you know, one day this is what happened. And I really regretted it so much. I hated myself so much and I blamed myself. As I was telling the Sayyid, the marja, the story, I noticed that he's in tears. I said, oh, I'm so sorry that I disappointed you. Perhaps maybe you are not expecting this from me to happen. He said, no, I'm not crying for you. I'm crying for myself. I'm crying for myself. And I was thinking that if I were you, perhaps I would also have the same expectation. Who can, for God's sake, who can other than Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam,